You just have to learn and play your part. You see, it's gonna get easy, it's gonna get easy, give it time. Aiming for change with a positive mind. Have a solid plan and follow the line. You see, it's gonna get easy, it's gonna get easy, give it time. We can only control what we can only control. Take it easy. Good things are coming your way right now. Lift your spirit up and let it run wild. Don't let other voices bring you down. You see, it's gonna get easy, it's gonna get easy, give it time. It's gonna get easy, no need to rush. We can only control what we can only control. Take it easy, good things are coming your way. Take it easy, no need to rush. We can only control what we can only control. Take it easy, good things are coming your way. It's gonna get easy, it's gonna get easy. Coming your way right now, right now, right now.
Thank you.
I want to invite to the Bima Dr. Reverend Keith Cox.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
What a beautiful song. So, yeah. Yes. So we're very happy to have back with us today Neve and Matan of Willow Mile. Yes. So welcome here along with Yaron Spiwak. So happy to have you here. And that's an original song, correct? Good. I'd love to get the lyrics at some point because it ties right into what we talk about here in, at the Center for Spiritual Living Los Angeles, as well as what I talk about often, and will be a little bit more this morning, which is the delusional state of control. And so, what do we have control of? But before we get into that, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How are we all doing today? Well, it's March 1st, the year 2020. Feels great, right? I know. We made it through the leap part of the leap year, correct? I believe we did. So happy to have you all here together with us this morning on a Sunday morning, this beautiful day in Southern California. Let's say hello to those watching us online and via live stream. We've got Rob over here in a new camera position. So hello to those of you. I'll look, let you see me in a new angle. And we are a Center for Spiritual Living Los Angeles, and we come together every Sunday morning to commune in the oneness of life, to use the premise and the teachings and the philosophy and the faith and the way of life known as the science of mind, to awaken ourselves to a greater understanding of our spiritual nature with the ultimate objective that we find personal self-empowerment on that journey. So I invite you to take a moment right now and turn off any electronic device that you have with you unless it's sustaining your life. Please turn that off and so that it doesn't ring or ding or oink or bark or whatever your call sign does right now. And we will continue on into the service as Willow Mile takes us into the next song. So beautiful, gentlemen. Thank you. So beautiful. And just take a moment and acknowledge that the third part of Willow Mile is not with us today, Atan. Anat. And I just looked it up to make sure I had it right. Anat online while you were singing. Anat, who is still in Israel.
Yes.
Correct?
Due to the coronavirus. So she can't leave the country right now.
Not that she's got it or anything.
Yeah.
So
she didn't get it. Yeah.
Here at the Center for Spiritual Living, we call it the Pomona virus. Yeah. Just not to buy into that traditional
the
language.
The promotional virus.
No, the Pomona. Since you're not an Angelino, it doesn't mean much to you, but it is the Pomona virus. But we're missing her, and I know that you are, and we're happy that the two of you are here, and thank you for sharing.
Thank you for having
so,
us.
Thank you. Yes. So as I was in the back of the room being mesmerized by Willow Mile, I was looking over their shoulder to the three words, evolution, embrace, compassion, which are words obviously on our sign. And it was, it prompted me to remember that we are here as awakened spiritual beings to embrace evolution and to do that with compassion. If you break down the word compassion, it means with passion. If you break down the word passion to pass I on, what we're being called to do there is to embrace the evolutionary process by passing on our divinity. We do that by knowing who we are as an individualized expression of the only thing that there is, which we call God. You can call it anything you want, but that's one word that we call it. And by not only knowing that, but honoring that in all aspects of life. And that's a very concise instruction and understanding of what we do here at the Center for Spiritual Living as we practice this philosophy, faith, and way of life known as the teachings of the science of mind. We're about to move into the next level of our service this morning, which is a ritual where we sing a song and light a candle. And I shared with you that for the year 2020, at least for the first quarter, we're going to use the song, Let There Be Peace on Earth. And not just from the perspective of some hope, not just from the perspective of a desire, but to break the word peace down to purposeful energy activates conscious evolution. The last line of the song is, let there be peace on earth and let it begin with me. What that lyric is calling us to do is to say, yes, it does begin with me, and it begins with me because I am consciously embracing the aspect of evolution through compassion by passing the I on. And what that means is that I'm purposefully using my energy of the divine in a way to activate conscious evolution for me. And because we're all interconnected and because the law of life that creates our experience for us is the same for all of us, that as I do so, it must ripple out to you. And if you're doing the same thing, it'll meet, fall in love, marry, and we will be peaceful, on and on and on. So with that instruction, let's sing the song. I'm going to light the candle for us, and I'm going to do it right now as I, before we sing it. And as we light this candle, we do so. I'm really trying to do this without looking. Letting it be a reminder to us that the light of life exists in all. And as we consciously use this light, peace indeed does begin with us.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be.
Close your eyes, feel this energy, of the resonance field of just simply that last statement, and let it begin with me. As I stated a moment ago, we are here to pass the I on. One way that we do that in this teaching is to affirm truth, affirm spiritual truth for ourselves and for others. Right now in our community, we have some that are in need of healing. And so the purpose of this stating, let there be peace and let it begin with me, is to begin in this very moment to affirm and to know that there is perfect health for those in our community and all of life that are ready to have a different experience than what is transpiring. And so I'm going to open up the room for those to say the names of anyone in your life out loud that you would like to have a healing, healing meaning the revelation of a greater understanding of the nature of the divine and the allness of life. Jody Carter. And the American people. Not said as a joke. Said in truth that not only have we affirmed for all of these individuals whose names we have spoken out loud, knowing that our words indeed have power, that the healing is already in play. And so I stated the American people because we are on the precipice right now of moving through this trajectory of where we have the opportunity to experience the democratic process. And so we affirm and know for the people of America that they vote from their heart, they allow the intelligence and wisdom of the divine to guide them. And remember in this place where we are so deeply connected, that it's through compassion, through reverence and respect, that evolution unfolds. And so we affirm right here and right now that evolution for the Center for Spiritual Living Los Angeles and the United States of America and all of humanity unfolds starting right now. And so we do our part because peace begins with us. Now, we are the agents of using our energy purposefully, activating conscious evolution. Today is the day, and we let it be as we say together, and so it is. Good. And so if you're new here, we've switched our service up a little bit, and for those of you that are maybe unfamiliar with that, I'm going to move right into our message for the day. And at the end of the message, we'll have an opportunity for some questions and or comments. I'd just like to encourage you that if you're going to ask them, which I do encourage you to ask them, to try not to tell the story beforehand, just ask the question. And that's me not trying to control the room. It's for the purpose of live streaming. That's what that's for. All right. And for those of you that are live streaming through Facebook Live, if you would like to send in a message, you can do so through Facebook, through the message there to Rob, and do so. So I'm going to begin today by talking about self-mastery. It's something that we've looked at a good bit in our class series that we're taking called The Mystical Nature of Conscious Evolution. And here's the definition that we have been using in this class. Self-mastery means to always take an active approach in life, being a performer more rather than a spectator. Now, I know several of you in the room definitely can relate to that statement, being a performer rather than a spectator. But what it means in this context is that being a performer rather than a spectator, when a situation obviously calls for a response, a self-mastered person takes initiative and steps up and steps right in. What it's telling us there is we're being called as a person of self-mastery in this practice of the philosophy and faith and way of life of the science of mind, or one who is consciously committing to be a conscious evolutionist, to live from this perspective of self-mastery. In the definition, an additional definition for this morning that I have for us, it's this. Self-mastery is the ability to recognize, understand, guide, and make the most out of your physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual self. It is gained through awareness, understanding, and accessed through thoughts, emotions, and actions. So think about that for a moment. We can access our ability to be a self-master on the journey of finding our personal self-empowerment through a spiritual awakening, through our thoughts, our actions, our reactions, and our interactions. With what? Well, with the very thing itself. Ernest Holmes refers to the power that we talk about, that we oftentimes refer to as G-O-D, but he also calls it source or spirit, or my favorite is the thing itself. But we access that through our thoughts and our actions and our reactions and our interactions in life. We oftentimes hear in this teaching that we become healed or abundant or awakened to the degree that we become conscious of it, meaning the very thing that we are seeking already exists within us, and we get to experience that very thing to the degree that we're willing to become conscious of it. And I would go on to say then have faith in the thing itself, that it must bring back to us an experience that is equal to that very thing or something greater. Now, I'm using this self-mastery as a jumping-off point for our theme for the month of March, which is abundance. And today's title and theme is to live in abundance, living in abundance through self-mastery. Well, what is abundance, one might ask? Well, the traditional definition for abundance is this: a very large quantity of something, the state or condition of having copious quantities of something. Plentifulness, plentifulness of good things. Is there anything anyone in this room might want that they think they don't have enough of? Okay, well, we're done then. Could you come back up and sing another song? Let me guess. It might be health. It might be money. It might be a sense of self-awareness. It might be love. It might be security. The list goes on and on and on. In the philosophy and the faith and the way of life known as the science of mind, abundance is the nature of the universe. So how do we live in abundance? Well, to live in abundance of something is to have more than you need, is a very basic approach to that. It's often used to describe positive qualities such as an abundance of love. But it's important to remember that abundance is the opposite of scarcity. An abundance of wealth is, if you will, a ton of cash. Now, a ton is a pretty broad word, but the question that I have for us and my goal today is for us to be able to expand our thinking beyond where we're at in our state of mind right now. Well, how do we live in abundance? Well, we do that through the act of self-mastery. We do that by stepping into where we are right now in the context of where we think we have scarcity in life or a lack of abundance, and look at that very thing and then begin to fine-tune our thinking as to who we are as a divine spiritual being, as opposed to trying to fix the problem. Why is that? Because in our philosophy, in our teaching, we're taught that every single thing that we desire to experience already exists in and as the mind of God. And our responsibility, should we desire to have more of it, is to have the consciousness of it. Therefore, our responsibility is to tend to our consciousness, our state of mind, our awareness, if you will, which is what Deepak Chopra tells us is the only thing there is. Now, I hear him say that oftentimes as he's talking in my little earbuds when I'm walking my beloved 411 spiritual offspring, Sweeney, down the street. And oftentimes I'll hear him say, all there is awareness. Now, that's a pretty big idea. Would you guys not agree with that? It's a pretty big idea. But if it's true, and I choose to believe that it's true because it's just different language addressing the same thing that Ernest Holmes talks about and many others talk about, which is that we just live in a world where every single thing in life is processed through the filter of our mental faculties. That's what he's telling us. And so if everything is awareness, then how do we live in abundance through that lens, if you will? Well, we do that with one's awareness or their consciousness, as Ernie calls it, or just traditional layman's terms, state of mind, must be a greater understanding that abundance is the nature of the universe. And since we are one with the universe, this must be our nature. So then, how do we live in and as it? The abundance that is our nature. Well, I think we do that once again through self-mastery. We do that by being a conscious participant via our thoughts, actions, reactions, interactions with our abundant nature. We do that by consciously creating a new perspective, consciously creating a new paradigm, consciously expanding our awareness. Now, Derek Rydell tells us that all that is required of us is to set the intention to have the experience, because inherent with every intention is the seed of its fulfillment. Using that as a baseline, I invite you in this very moment to set the intention to have a greater consciousness and awareness and a state of mind of your nature as an abundant being. If you're willing to do that, please raise your right hand. Right hand. Okay, I'm just kidding. Now, I'm just playing with you. And I'm not at the same time. In fact, old school metaphysicians would have you do this. Please affirm with me. Today is the day.
I expand
my awareness, understanding, and acceptance, and act in accordance to my abundant nature, which is that of the universe. It is done. Now, how easy is that? Yes, and I am being tongue-in-cheek, and I'm not. It really is that easy, because what we collectively just did and individually was set the intention. And Derek Rydell tells us that what we're called to do is to know, which is what Deepak's also telling us, is all that we need is awareness. Once we have the awareness that what we're called to do is to set the intention, then the seed of its fulfillment is already in place. Well, then what happens? We need to shut the hell up and have the faith of God, Ernest tells us, for it to move through us. Not come at us like an asteroid, to move through us so that we're receptive to it when it comes that way. Now, I was joking, and not when I said shut the hell up. In the context of, means that we need to stop the chatter once we've done that. Don't have the affirmation, don't set the intention, and then immediately turn to your right and go, well, I wonder if that's going to come true, right? Or, you know, based on my previous three experiences, right? No. Let it sink in. If you use the analogy of a seed, you plant it and let it sink in, so that it can take root and then grow. That's the same thing relative to a new paradigm, a new state of mind, a new consciousness. Ernest Holmes tells us that what we're in the very first chapter of the book of how we're to do that, in the chapter of the thing itself, he says, we are to see abundance in the universe. The very first chapter, he tells us, he goes, we, and he not only says we are to see, he says, we see abundance in the universe. It's already there. But are we tuning into it, is the question. Well, he goes on to tell us we cannot count the grains of sand on a single beach. Nor would you want to try, right? He goes, we can't count the grains of sand on a single beach. The earth contains untold riches. Here's my favorite part. And the very air is vibrant with power. Why then is the human weak, poor, and afraid? So right now, in your mind's eye, begin to see, in your mind's eye, a beach. How many likes the beach in the room? Right? You lay there just to get that glorious tan and to appreciate the water. Have you ever stopped to think about the grains of sand that were there? And what if each one of those was a molecule which represented cash, or health, or peace, or power, or food, or jobs, or healing energy, or cash. I know that's the one that's on everybody's mind. But think about it. If you're looking at those grains of sand, you can start to potentially comprehend what's around you, right? Especially those that get in your flip-flop, right? Or in the crevice of your swimsuit, right? That's rubbing a little bit, but those grains just keep going, right? Far beyond what the eye can see on just the beach you're on. But if you think about it, and I want you to, it goes all the way around. Just that piece of earth that is in the ocean. And headed out underneath the onion of the ocean are the grains of sand. So just use that very simple exercise as an exercise to begin to broaden your awareness of the abundant nature that exists in the universe, not just through grains of sand, but then see that as money or molecules of health, or whatever it is you desire to have more of in your life that right now may be some sense of scarcity that's in your mind. I know personally this week, I got just a little bit nauseous even about to tell it, was watching the stock market. Anybody else? Ooh, mm-hmm. Girl, that's all I can say. And after Friday, I was like, I got to turn this off. This is not my reality. This is an experience of the reality. Turn it off, stop paying attention to it. Same thing with the Pomona virus. Stop looking at it, stop talking about it. It doesn't mean to not be wise, to not use our intelligence, to not understand that as humans, there are things for us to do to protect ourselves on the journey of life and other chaos that we all know is unfolding in the world. But to take a step back and ask ourselves, has spiritual truth changed? The answer is no. Well, then, if a spiritual truth is the universe's nature is abundant, has that changed? No. And if we are one with that which is the universe and its nature is abundant, has our nature changed then? Mm-mm. But it's up to us to make sure we know that. It's up to us to step into our evolutionary process of expanding our ideas, of an understanding of our truth, to know who we are as spiritual beings and the capacity that we have to use our minds in a way to reveal our divine nature and then have the faith of God to let the experiences show up that is relative and reflective of our divine nature. It's important for us to know that in those moments when we feel scarcity or loss or fear, that what has possibly changed in that moment is our awareness, our faith, our engagement in truth, the way that we live our life, the way that we choose to give in our life, and what we're verbally affirming out there, and how we are using our capacity to use spiritual mind treatment. But it's important for us to remember that this is still true for us, that we are on a journey of personal self-empowerment through a spiritual awakening, that conscious evolution is transpiring by nature of humanity, and we get to evolve if we choose to be a part of that, that the micro is taking place at all times, as is the macro in the experiential experience of life. That the absolute still exists and the relative still exists. That the universal spiritual laws are infinitely at work because they always have been and they always will be. And no matter what, we are always at choice. And so this weekend, as I was preparing for this message and beginning to reflect on my personal experience of getting drawn into watching the news or drawn into watching the stock market or blah, blah, whatever happens, I thought, what is the one thing in my life that grounds me? And one of the things that grounds me and always has and has this visceral emotional experience, so I might cry when I read it to you, are the Declaration of Principles by Dr. Ernest Holmes for the Teachings of the Science of Mind. And I'm going to read a portion of them to you to use as a jumping off point as you now continue to have this experience in your life of being a more abundant being, because we've set the intention for that to happen. And he tells us in the very beginning of this Declarations of Principles, and I'm going to state it in the I, that there's only one God. And he says, I believe in God, the living Almighty, one indestructible, absolute, and self-existent cause. This one manifests itself in and through all creation, but is not absorbed by its creation. The manifest universe is the body of God. It is the logical and necessary outcome of the infinite self-knowingness of God. And then to tell us that, well, then everything is spirit, the Declaration of Principles says, I believe in the incarnation of the Spirit in all beings, and that every person is an incarnation of the one Spirit. And then he goes on to tell us that I believe in the eternality, the immortality, and the continuity of the individual soul forever and ever expanding. And I believe that the kingdom of heaven is within. And then I get to experience this kingdom to the degree that I become conscious of it. That's the key. Right there, that no matter what is going on in life, what am I willing to do, to be, to become more conscious of the one God, of the incarnation of Spirit, and that this power itself that moves into my body and your body is eternal, immortal, and it enhances itself as the continuity of the individual soul forever and ever expanding. What he's telling us here is that once we develop this consciousness of this and understand that no matter what's going on in life, because our nature is that of the nature, is the nature of the nature, and is abundant by nature, that as we ride this ride, the nature of this power through us in our soul is forever and ever and ever expanding. But what we've learned is that for you and I to get to experience that expansion, we must be willing to own it. We must be willing to do our part in that. Well, how do we do that? Certainly we know in traditional metaphysical terms that we do that by changing our thinking and changing our world. And I think that that's become just a very foundation for us in this teaching. I think what we're really called to do here, which we've been looking at in class, is to court the presence of what Ernest calls this living almighty power. To court its presence. In other words, to consciously commune with the power that exists within us. To ask ourselves in every single situation, do I see, taste, touch, feel, and experience the divine? Because the presence is there, whether we're consciously courting it or not. But yet as we choose to consciously court that presence, then we expand our own soul, not just waiting for it to expand on its own. And in so doing, we expand our consciousness, our awareness, our awakened state of our spirituality, if you will. And in so doing, evolve into a higher consciousness. And in so doing, align ourselves more with the very power that we're talking about. We looked at that through the map of consciousness, knowing that what we're called to do is to constantly be evolving into a higher state of the very thing that is, of the one mind. Ernest says to us, there is one infinite mind from which all things come. Now remember, all things exist within this nature of abundance. This mind is through, in, and around the human. It is the only mind there is, and every time the human thinks they use it, it's there. There is one infinite substance, and every time the human moves, they move in it. What he's telling us is that it's there with us, baby. It's there. Every time we move, we're moving in it and as it. So there is no need whatsoever to have a state of mind, a consciousness, or an awareness that is steeped in lack, for it to be steeped in spiritual truth, of abundance, of oneness, of that there is no scarcity. Well, how do we do that? One of the great tools that Ernest gave us to do that is called spiritual mind treatment. And if you've been around for a while, it was once 7 steps, and now it's 5 steps. And I think it's important for us to know those steps. But most importantly, it's important for us to know what its purpose is. And its purpose is to develop, to claim a state of mind, an awareness of these spiritual truths and our role in this co-creative process, and hold on to that till it shows up as an experience. And to constantly be fine-tuning our mind to know who we are as a divine being, but also how we are using our mind. He tells us that spiritual mind treatment should incorporate a conscious recognition that abundance always has been ours, as has happiness and peace, and to know that they're ours right now, for they are the very essence and truth of our being. And so this week in class, I created a great handout for us to look at spiritual mind treatment in a new way. And I'll share it with you right now. And it's a visual representation of understanding that there's only oneness taking place, and to remember that every individual is an infinite, a unique manifestation of the whole, meaning that as we're looking at life from an abundant being, an abundant nature, is that because we're all unique, what one person experiences in abundance, which may look different from ours, doesn't mean they're taking some of ours, or if we have more than someone else, we're not taking theirs. It's all interconnected, and there's enough for everybody, and we're here to express our unique expression as individuals. And then to create a vision for the very thing that we desire to experience in life. Because our visual capacities matter, whether we're using external vision or internal vision, and then to remember that our words have power, so that when we open our mouth and speak truth. And then from there, we looked at faith, to remember that faith is the strength of the soul. And then from living in that faith, to understand that the spiritual law of the universe is doing its part. Period. It's doing its part. Whether you ride the ride consciously or not, it's still doing its part. And then to know that once you release this development, to get ready and bring forth into your world the manifestation, the demonstration, the experience of the state of mind that you've developed in this treatment. Abundance is your nature. Let today be the day that you choose to be more abundant in every avenue of your life. Wayne Dyer tells us that abundance is not something we acquire. It's something we tune into. Now, for the last 96 weeks, no, I'm just kidding, but certainly for the last 2.5 months, I've talked to all of us about changing our vibration, of aligning our vibration into our true nature. Because Marianne Williamson tells us that the key to abundance is meeting what appears to be a limited circumstance with an unlimited state of mind. In other words, to consciously be constantly developing our consciousness. And Bob Proctor tells us to see yourself living in abundance and you will attract it. It always works. It works every time with every person. Why is that? Because that spiritual law of life is impersonal. So today, see what you may think is invisible, believe what is incredible, and be ready to receive what you may think is impossible. But it's not, because the world is full of abundance and opportunity. But far too many of us come to the fountain of life with a sieve instead of a tank car, a teaspoon instead of a tea shovel, a steam shovel. You expect little, and as a result, you get little. And so today, try not to walk out of here saying, okay, well, I have 14 cents in my pocket and I'm going to attract $1 million. Walk out of here saying, I have 14 cents in my pocket and I'm attracting $114 or $1,000.14. Use your mind in a way that is evolving, but is also understandable, that you can wrap your head around it. And then have that experience, and once you do, be ready for the next step, and the next step, and the next step, because we're each on a journey, a step-by-step journey of personal self-empowerment, and the only way that we can do that is by having the spiritual awakening. And so my intention and my goal today is for each of us to have that spiritual awakening, to know in a way that we've never known before that abundance is our nature, and therefore we commit to living a life in abundance. Thank you. Do we have any questions?
Would you pass around that flyer?
I will.
Thank you.
Is that the only question? Yes, Donald Wayne.
I'm wondering
if I what? I'm sorry.
If you had speculated what the possible mental equivalent is of this potential unfortunate situation that has the appearance of sweeping the world, because we need to neutralize that intensity of thought.
So are you asking me if I have possibly thought of what is the mental equivalent to the coronavirus? I haven't. But here's my take on it. I don't know that the mental equivalent is what matters right now. I think what matters is that we understand that we do have the capacity to reveal health as opposed to a lack of health, that we know. And so we also know that when one or more is gathered, the power magnifies. And so I think as often as we can speak truth of having it disappear and health manifest itself, then now's the time. That's that, I believe that. It's not that I don't believe that there's a mental equivalent. I do believe there is a mental equivalent. I just don't know that I'm the one to name that. But I can tell you what I believe is contributing to it. I think it's an empirical nature of humanity. It's a high level of the haves and the have-nots. You know, we have a glimpse of that here in the first world country known as United States of America in the city of Los Angeles. But all that we have to do is walk out our front doors and see that there are people that are living in substandard conditions. And oftentimes we as a collective have become quite numb to it. I think that's part of it. I think that it could be a way that Mother Earth is screaming back at us. And I think it could be, and I don't think it necessarily is one of these items. I think it's the collective. We were having this conversation at dinner Friday night where I think if you look at the toxicity that's been unfolding in just our political system, right, that has power. If you look at what we're doing to Mother Earth, that has power, right? If you look at how we've separated ourselves from a large portion of humanity, that has power, right? So there are pieces after pieces after pieces after pieces after pieces after pieces after pieces of the puzzle where we are not doing better. And Maya Angelou tells us that when we know better, we do better. And I take exception with that. We don't. When we know better, we know that we should do better. It doesn't mean that we do better, right? So, but what we know in this philosophy and faith and teaching is that we have the ability to turn everything on a dime, but we also know that just like peace, it must begin with me. So part of the reason I wanted to give this message this morning about abundance is so that we, every single one of us, chooses to be a more abundant being today in all areas of our life. And one area of that might be that we really think about how we're treating Mother Earth. You know? Because she's not happy. Yes, Tom. So just what's the question? I just need to get the question. Okay. So the question is, how do we transmute the toxicity or neutralize it? Well, we do it the same way that we do everything else. We return to God, to the source, the Almighty. And we do that by speaking our word, by our actions. Remember, it's about what are our actions, our thoughts, our beliefs, our reactions, and our interactions with life itself. That's ours to do at the absolute level, right? And then at the human level, ask yourself on a daily basis, what are you doing that may be propagating that? How can you be different, right? And most importantly, vote. If you're talking about the political system, vote. And reach out to everyone that you know and have them vote. So the challenge that so often many of us have is that we want everybody to vote, but we want them to vote for our candidate. And that's not the way democracy works. You know, people have the right to exercise their right, right? And I think to also, I'm going to encourage you to reach across the aisle. You know, to reach out to someone that thinks differently than you do and just say to them, you know, we're in a really unique place in our country today. So talk to me about what's going on. We don't have to walk away and agree. Just talk to me. You know, I think that's something to do. Yes, Tom. Okay, so the question is, how do you hang on to the state of consciousness today? You practice it. The human mind, if you repeat something 21 times, it goes deeper into your subconscious. So make a commitment to 21 days, doing something every single day, which could be the same thing, to expand your mental awareness that you're an abundant being. I didn't read these because I've run out of time, but there's... Let me get to it. So here are some tips. So have an abundance mentality. Be grateful for what you have. Smile. Start your days right. Prepare yourself for opportunities. Build friendships along the way. So those are all ways to expand that abundance mentality. But I think it's creating a course and sticking to it, both whether that's you get on your calendar every single day at 9 a.m., remind me I'm an abundant being, and for me to take action. That's how I do it. I give myself reminders. My students know that. I give myself reminders, and they go on my phone all day. But I'm going to tell you there's one other way to do that, and this is a little bit self-promotion. Come to class on Thursday nights. Who's in class in the room, right? Do you feel like you're more in tune with how to address life on a daily basis?
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. So... I know there's a lot of traffic to get here, but what a great way to remind you of abundance than sitting in traffic, right? Look at all the abundance of automobiles and people and brake lights and smog and all of that, right? It's not what one...
And that you're in a car.
And that you're in a car. Or you may own it or GM may owns it or whatever, but yeah, you're traveling, right? Thank you, Tom. Yes, one more, Dan, and then we'll move on. You walk up to them, you don't wash your hands, you put your hands on your forehead and they say, you have no power here, be gone. I'm just kidding. You look at that as an opportunity to affirm spiritual truth. And in your mind, you look at them and say, you are the perfection, the wholeness, and the completeness of God. And I affirm for you right now, an awakening is unfolding in your life. That's what you do. So now, why do you do that? Why does one want to do that? Because you're doing it for yourself. You're bringing yourself back to center, and we know our words have power, and from there, got it? That's what you do, right? That's because then you're grounding yourself, you're developing a consciousness of oneness, and so eventually you see them and you know they don't have any power. Now, it doesn't mean that sometimes you can't sit on the sidelines and take it in as entertainment, right? But just know what you're taking in. Yeah, good. All right. So, everybody, say with me together, please. Today is the day.
Today is the day.
I commit and covenant with myself. I am an abundant being. My actions reflect this. So I give and I honor the universe of its abundance. By acting in accordance. And so it is. Good. So on that note, if time for our collection, if I can have our ushers come up. What a perfect opportunity to expand your abundant nature. Just to remind you that we won't be here next Sunday, so we'll be happy to celebrate that with your conscious giving today to cover next Sunday, because our business is still functioning and we still pay for all of it. So know that that's greatly appreciated. Also, back to me, I'm not quite done yet. Also, throughout the week, if you feel so compelled to continue in your abundant nature and give to support us next week, you can go to our website, csl-la.org, and donate there. And the method is there through cash. Here is through cash or check. Or if you're doing it electronically, it's through our website. Click on the donate button or through the app in the App Store. I'm going to put Rob on the spot a little bit, but we can probably find a YouTube channel video from the past that we can put on this week's newsletter that you guys can watch next Sunday and pretend like you're here. Right? We can do that? Good. So you can do that. And if you haven't donated throughout the week when the time has unfolded, if you do that, then next Sunday you can do that as well. And we will continue to honor your conscious giving to CSLLA by continuing to be a tithing organization to give to places that matter. And so I'm going to use my phone because I gave electronically. Take that which you're giving and place close to your heart. We've done our affirmation already today, and so we're going to just do one quick one and then sing the song, Love is My Decision. So I affirm for each of us the very nature of the universe, which is abundant, is indeed ours. And we're giving right now in a way that reflects this expanded idea for ourselves. And we're deeply grateful for the opportunity to do so. And so it is.
So it is.
The lyrics are on your handout.
Love is my decision.
It's up to me.
Give of my heart, love is my decision.
No one else tell me to stop.
Once I decide to change my mind,
wonderful. Thank you, gentlemen. All right, so I'm going to give you a good heads up on what's going down here at the C to the S to the L to the A. We're in class 6 this week of the mystical nature of conscious evolution. Please come. We would love to have you there. We're having a really good time, and we had a lot of fun last Thursday night as well. Just a reminder, there will not be a service in here on next Sunday morning. We'll make sure that you have access to our YouTube channel to see something that'll be either through our website and on our weekly e-newsletter. So make sure to check that out. A reminder, our website is csl-la.org. You can also find us in all of the social media sites, and the TV in the lobby tells all that as well. And I'm going to acknowledge who we want to acknowledge today. Please hold your applause till the end. Our practitioner of the day is Reverend Lenore Edney. Our table is being handled in the back, our welcome table, through Wendy Waris. I was the illuminator, and Connie Schneider is our board member on duty. Our sound and setup is Travis Smith and Jesus Ernesto Reyes. Facebook Live is Rob Hensley. Our musicians are Yaron, Neve, and Matan. Let's give everyone a great round. So two things before we close. One is there are sweets in the back, and there are sweets in the back, so feel free to have your sweets if you would like to do that with coffee and creamer. Also, as you heard me say at the beginning of our service, that we had some of our members that needed support, and being that we do have some congregants, and it's not necessarily about age, but some of them are older, that if you or anyone that you know is in need throughout the week, please reach out to me or one of our practitioners and let us know. You know, unfortunately in this teaching, sometimes there's shame around being ill or that you have needs, and people think that that's not living your divine truth, and that's just simply not true. And so when I was sick a couple of weeks ago, one of the reasons I spread the word, not the virus, but the word, to make sure everybody knows, hey, it happens, we're humans. We're humans navigating this planet. And so please know to reach out, and I share that with you because we can't reach to you if we don't know that there's something that's needed. So I just want to remind you of that. Yes, did you have something, Carol?
There is blueberry, oak flower, blueberry,
almond flower. All right. So with that said, let's enjoy. You are an abundant being. Let's let that be. Let's have our last song by Willow Mile, please.
I won't let you down. Please don't give me up. Gotta have some faith in the sound. It's the one good thing that I've got. I won't let you down. So please don't give me up. 'Cause I would really, really love to stick around, oh yeah. Didn't know what I wanted to be.
Didn't know what I wanted to be.
I was every little hungry schoolgirl, pride and joy, and I guess it was enough for me.
Guess it was enough for me.
To win the race, to clear your face, a brand new clothing, big fat place on a rock and roll TV.
Rock and roll TV. Rock and roll TV.
You play the game, it's not the same, no way.
Ever gonna let myself happy.
I think there's something you should know.
I think it's time I told you so.
There's something deep inside of me.
There's someone else I've got to be.
Take out your picture in the frame. Hope you understand. Sometimes the bad may not make the man. All you have to do now is take these lies and make them true.
Somehow,
all we have to see is that I don't belong to you and you don't belong to me. Yeah, yeah.
Sound.
It's a one good thing that I've got. I won't let you down. So please don't give me up. 'Cause I would really, really love to stick around. Oh yeah. Well, it looks like
the road to heaven, but it feels like the road to hell. When I knew which way my bread was buttered, I took the knife as well. I'm posing for another picture where everybody got to sell. But when you shake it fast and notice fast, some mistakes were built to last.
Yes. That's what you get. That's what you get.
I said that's what you get.
That's what you get.
I said that's what you get for changing your mind. You get for changing your mind. That's what you get.
That's what you get.
I said that's what you get after
that's
all this
what you
time.
Get.
Or I just hope you understand. Sometimes the clothes do not make the man.
Take these lies and make them true somehow. All we have to see is that I don't belong to you and you don't belong to me. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I won't let you down.
Freedom.
I will not give you up.
Freedom.
Gotta have some faith in
gotta
the sound.
Keep it
it's the one good thing that I've
got.
I won't let you down.
Freedom.
So please don't. Cause I would really, really love to stick around. Oh, I won't let you down, so please don't give me up. Gotta have some faith in the sound.
Willow Mile.
Thank you very much.
I hope my singing back there wasn't bothering you. Doing my best to harmonize. And so in the vein of freedom, let's all use it to close our eyes in this moment as we end this service. The last lyrics were, I won't let you down, so please don't give me up. That's the voice of the divine speaking to us right now. So as we close in meditation, as I now extinguish the light of the candle here in the room, but ignite it within you. It's that place within of an inner calling that we say yes to live in freedom, being free from any old ideology, from any attachment to scarcity or lack, or any emotional state to what was. We give ourselves the freedom right now to be renewed in and as the power of the divine, the Almighty One, as Ernest tells us. And so seeing this flickering flame of the candle within us right now, each one of us, we see it in our own soul. We let it be a reminder to consciously reflect and replicate the nature of abundance in our actions, in our reactions, in our thoughts, and our interactions with this very precious thing called life. And so today is the day that we love more, we give more, and we have greater faith. And what a joyous ride it is. And we let it be. And say together. And so it is. Thank you. Enjoy the sweets and the others and the teas and all of you. And a huge thank you to Willow Mile and Yaron. And have a great 2 weeks. I'll see you all in 2 Sundays and in class. Namaste, homie. Okay.